Thank you once again for tuning in and joining us in a time of praise and worship as we look into God's Word and allow the Holy Spirit to minister to each one of us. If the doors of your church have reopened for corporate worship and you were able to attend your first services for the month of October, what kind of worship experience did you have? Was it the same as before lockdown, or was church different post the COVID-19 pandemic? Did you experience a new sense of excitement, more than just seeing your fellow worshippers? Did you have a true sense of God's presence that so permeated the atmosphere that it energized you to get right on into embracing the new future norm with all its new challenges that will be facing the Church of Jesus Christ? At our first Alive Ministers Fraternal a week ago, we as pastors grappled with how do we lead our congregations and encourage them to appropriately respond to the demands of the new norm. We have to be honest that we don't have all the answers, but we have this confidence that although we may be in the dark about all of the future, we have the light of the world, Jesus Himself, to lead us forward into whatever the new norm will throw at us. So our scripture reading for this morning is taken from 1 Samuel 3, verse 1 to 11. The boy Samuel ministered before the Lord under Eli in those days. The word of the Lord was rare, and there were not many visions. One night, Eli, whose eyes were becoming so weak that he could barely see, was lying down in his usual place. The lamp of God had not yet gone out, and Samuel was lying down in the house of the Lord where the ark of God was. Then the Lord called, "Samuel, Samuel." And he answered, "Here am I." And he ran to Eli and said, "Here am I. You called me." But Eli said, "I did not call you. Go back and lie down." So he went and lay down. Again the Lord called, "Samuel." And Samuel got up and went to Eli and said, "Here I am. You called me." "My son," Eli said, "I did not call you. Go back and lie down." Now Samuel did not yet know the Lord. The word of the Lord had not yet been revealed to him. A third time the Lord called Samuel. And Samuel got up and went to Eli and said, "Here I am. You called me." Then Eli realized that the Lord was calling the boy. So Eli told Samuel, "Go and lie down, and if he called you, say, 'Speak, Lord, for your servant is listening.'" So Samuel went and lay down in his place. The Lord came and stood there calling as at other times, "Samuel, Samuel." Then Samuel said, "Speak, Lord, for your servant is listening." And the Lord said to Samuel, "See, I am about to do something in Israel that will make the ears of everyone who hear about it tingle." Our key verse is taken from 1 Samuel 3, verse 3. The lamp of God had not yet gone out. Let's pray together. Father, we thank you so much this morning that we can come in the wonderful name of your Son, our Savior, the Lord Jesus, to ask that once again, by your Spirit's power, you will come and minister to each one of us as we allow the bread of life to be broken. May we feed this morning on that which you have prepared for us, and drink deep from the fountains of life. And may we be so energized as we hear from you that we will want to shine your light wherever we may be. We come against everything that would try to hinder that light from shining, and we stop it in Jesus' name as we plead the precious blood over the service. And all God's people said, Amen. One of the effects that COVID-19 coronavirus has had on a number of churches that do not have their own buildings has been their struggle to keep up with the payments of rent or faced eviction. It was painful to listen to pastors during a Zoom webinar session who had been threatened by landlords to have the lights cut, depriving the congregation of electricity supply. In the midst of the pandemic, we have had to deal with load shedding, as our homes were plunged into total darkness for a number of days. Shallow-sitting has become so part of the new norm, we just have to accept these dark moments and get used to the darkness as we move into the future. But the spiritual pandemic has plunged many into a state of spiritual darkness, which has not been easy to deal with, so the darkness still hangs over many lives and many homes. Even though we are now in level 1, the darkness have not lifted. The heaviness still seems to be bearing down on us. Now, this was the state of the earth at the beginning of time, formless, dark, empty, and without void. In the Old Testament, the very first recorded words in Scripture, we have God speaking to the darkness in Genesis 1, 3 and 4. And God said, "Let there be light," and there was light. And God saw the light, that it was good, and God divided the light from the darkness. As we come to the New Testament, and the Gospel of John gives us the fleshing out of Genesis 1, 3. When John pens the first words of his Gospel, John 1, verse 1 to 9, he says, "In the beginning was the Word, and the Word was with God, and the Word was God. In him was life, and the life was the light of men. And the light shines in the darkness, and the darkness comprehended it not. There was a man sent from God whose name was John. He was not that light, but was sent to bear witness of that light. That was the true light, which gives light to every man that comes into the world." Now, as we turn to our text, it is odd that the writer would start this segment of Israel's history with reference to the lamp in the temple. You see, the lamp was an illumination through the Spirit of God, because it embodied the very presence of the Lord in the Ark of the Covenant. The first thing that Samuel encountered as he started to serve in the house of the Lord was that the temple light was about to go out, because the presence of the Lord was waning. It is significant that the Bible makes reference to what may seem like a small matter regarding the brightness of the lights. But as the temple was about to be plunged into darkness, it is indicative of the spiritual darkness that had descended over the people of God. What seemed like a trivial detail calls for our attention to learn some important lessons from the flickering lamps in the temple. And this brings us to point number one. Point number one, attention, the switch is off. 1 Samuel 3 verse 1. The boy Samuel was serving God under Eli's direction. This was at a time when the revelation of God was rarely heard or seen. We are called to attention as the flickering lights were about to be switched off. This was indicative of the inconsistencies that were flickering in the lives of the main characters and the people of God at this time in the history of Israel. One, the flickering priest. 1 Samuel 3 verse 2 says, "One night Eli, whose eyes were becoming so weak that he could barely see, was lying down in his usual place." You see, the Bible says of Eli that his eyes had rolled in and his vision was poor. His decisions were spasmodic. Sometimes he would do the right thing and sometimes he would do the weak thing. And just as much as the light is flickering in the temple, the old man is flickering too. His season of power and authority and clarity was winding down, just as the brightness of the temple lights. Secondly, we have a flickering people. The children of Israel had gotten to a point where they were avoided coming into worship because of their seduction to idolatry. This was the same time when the revelation of God was rarely heard or visions were seen. This caused them to be inconsistent in their conduct towards God. They were a flickering people, just like the flickering flame in the temple. Number three, we have a flickering partners. To crown it all, the sons of Eli, Phinehas and Hophni, were so far from God to the extent that they did not know the Lord any longer. Instead of them being shining examples alongside their father as priests, their lights had gone out completely. They were not illuminating the light of God's word any longer. Their conduct as men of God had become so uncomely and dishonoring to their call as servants of God. So the question to each one of us is, if the lights could be seen for each one of us, would we be shining brightly, or would our lights be flickering too? Before we condemn the priest, the people, and the partners in the passage, are our spiritual lights consistently shining brightly, or have we become nothing but a flickering lamp? Has the darkness of the pandemic caused us to become sometimes hot or cold, sometimes right or wrong, sometimes strong or weak, and sometimes wise or unwise? Let's remember, the flickering light was in the temple. It was spasmodic, but it was actually in the temple. Maybe there are some who are attending church today with a flickering lamp. They're not sure if they sometimes on or sometimes off in the way that they worship the Lord. But they could not wait to get back to church. Thank God that He has not given upon us. And every now and then He will send somebody to help us to tend our lamps with a song, with a word, with a prophecy, to remind us that we have to keep our lamps trimmed and burning. Because we are living in a world where the lights have been switched off, and people all around us are groping in total darkness. The one that John said in chapter 3, verse 19 and 20, this is the verdict. Light has come into the world, but people love darkness instead of light because their deeds were evil. Everyone who does the evil hates the light and will not come into the light, for fear of their deeds will be exposed. See, the situation in Israel was so dark that the revelation of words from the Lord had literally no effect on the way they were living in the dark. Need I to elaborate on the situations that surround us in our communities, around our churches? It seems as if the pandemic has been a catalyst for an unprecedented rise in the dark deeds that has spiked over the last 6 months. The dark side of the virus has caused crime to be on the increase, which has taken crime to another level. The murder and rape statistics has been most shocking. When you look at the gruesome, violent pain that has been inflicted on innocent victims. There's a new darkness that has caused our families to live in fear for the lives of our children, as the kidnapping of children are on the increase. Not forgetting the darkness that has gripped many families, as poverty and their livelihood has been affected by loss of employment due to the pandemic. You see, even relationships have been highly affected by the strain and the tension brought on our families, not being able to handle the effects of the pandemic. The list can go on and on. Read the challenges that the Church of Jesus will have to face in the new norm. The days of the church building being seen as the lighthouse in our communities must change. The church building must become the power station that refuels its members to be true light bearers in the midst of all the darkness around. Going back to church should be all about equipping every child of God to live out the little song. Do not wait until some deed of greatness you may do. Do not wait to shed your light afar. To the many duties ever near you now be true. Brighten the corner where you are. Brighten the corner where you are. Brighten the corner where you are. Someone far from harbor you may guide across the bar. Brighten the corner where you are. This brings us to our second point. Point number 2. Awake from your slumber. 1 Samuel 1 verse 3 says, the lamp of God had not yet gone out, and Samuel was lying down in the house of the Lord. Oh, how Israel needed a fresh, bright light to shine in the darkness of their lives. It was so ravaged by their sinful choices. So God doesn't call Samuel during the day, but God chooses to call him in the night. that is so indicative of darkness. You see, the church needs to wake up from its state of slumber. It is as if we have fallen asleep, and our lights are not shining brightly enough to dispel the darkness all around us. Have we allowed the pandemic to cause us to become so comfortable in our belief of God that we think God is our lazy boy chair in which we can curl up to read our theological books and be left to shine less? God did not say, I won't bother Samuel till morning because he needs his sleep time. The moment the boy's head hit the pillow, before he could curl up into a fetal position for a good night's sleep, God calls out, Samuel! Samuel! The boy jumps out of bed because he was called to serve in the temple. You see, when Samuel heard the voice, he thought it was Eli. And he goes to Eli and says, you called me. And Eli says, I called thee not. Go back to bed and lie down. He goes back and lies down in the darkness of the temple. And God called a second time Samuel, and he leaps up again and goes to Eli and says, you called me. He says, I called you not. You see, some of us are stuck in our slumber after lazing about so much during the pandemic that we have become indifferent to the voice of God calling us. When you're not serving as a light bearer, you will cover your head and ignore the call. But when your lamp is trimmed and burning brightly, you will heed the call and be ready to serve. Because it is God who is calling you. It is God who is disturbing you from your slumber. It is God who is letting you know, I have something for you to do in some dark situation. It is God that is telling you that there is someone who needs you to light up their lives. But you're not hearing God. So you keep running to the flesh. Flesh can never respond to the call of God. Flesh will always send you back disappointed. Because what God is wanting to do through your shining light, no flesh can handle. That's why Ephesians 5, 6 and following says, let no one deceive you with empty words. For because of such things, God's wrath comes on those who are disobedient. Therefore, do not be partners with them. For you were once darkness, but now you are light in the Lord. Live as children of light. For the fruit of the light consists in all goodness, righteousness, and truth. And find out what pleases the Lord. Have nothing to do with fruitless deeds of darkness, but rather expose them. It's a shameful even to mention what the disobedient do in secret, but everything exposed by the light becomes visible, and everything that is illuminated becomes light. This is why it is said, wake up, sleeper, rise from the dead, and Christ will shine on you. If we have been lulled to sleep by the enemy of our souls, God has brought us through the pandemic back to church to wake us up to the fact that our communities are in grave darkness, and we need to take the light of the gospel to them. This is a wake-up call that we cannot ignore. We must arise like Samuel from our slumber and declare like Jesus did in John 9:4, as long as it is day, we must do the works of him who sent me. Night is coming when no man can work. While I'm in the world, I am the light of the world. This brings us to point number three. Point number three, attune your ear to the sound. 1 Samuel 3, verse 8 and 9, then Eli realized that the Lord was calling the boy. So Eli told Samuel, go and lie down. And if he calls you, say, speak, Lord, for your servant is listening. If going back to church is all about being refueled to let our light shine brightly into the darkness, then maybe we must start shining firstly in the household of faith. We should be modeling our role as the best light bearers to the young people in our churches. Eli was getting old, and he was no longer had the energy to jump out of bed like young Samuel. His best days were behind him. Eli's ears were going, just like his eyes were going, and he could no longer see the flickering light clearly, nor could he hear the sound of the voice. But although he couldn't hear, he could understand. His role now was to help young Samuel take up the challenge to shine in response to God's call to serve in the temple. Like young Samuel, we have more than enough young, strong, promising, vibrant young people in our churches. Their youthfulness makes them sensitive. Their youthfulness alerts them to respond more quickly to the needs of our society all around us. Do you know that every major revolution that has taken place in this country has happened out of the mouths of our young people who said, "We are sick and tired of it, and we are not taking it anymore." From women's rights to civil rights to every kind of injustice, our youth are a bunch of radical young people who are willing to break rules to bring about change and say, "Hold on, no more. You can't beat it out of us. You can't whip it out of us." And in the midst of their frustration, our young people need guidance. They need to see us as the Church of Jesus Christ make fresh commitments to take the light of the gospel into the dark places as we enter the new norm. Samuel was strong and he could hear someone calling him. He could hear sound that Eli could not hear, but only Eli could understand it. That's why on the third time Samuel said, came to Eli and said, "Did you call me?" The Bible says Eli perceived it. He didn't hear it, but he perceived it. He could not hear it anymore, but he had enough experience to know that there was something in the call to Samuel. There was a reason why the young man was disturbed from his sleep. We have young people in our churches and they may be seen as disruptive because of all the energy they have. We must harness that energy and not always see there's something bad. We have to be wise enough to perceive that there's good in our youth, to be true light bearers into the future and show them that God needs them to help us shine into the darkness all around us. Let us attune our ears to the sound and say to our young people, your strength to shine may take on a different mode to the way we tried to let our light shine. Let us encourage them to join hands with us. With their energy and our experience, we can make a difference in this dark world. Like the proverb goes, many hands make light work. We need to be honest with our youth and admit that we can't see the remote control without putting our specs. That we struggle with programming our cell phones. That we may not know how to search Google and Facebook and Instagram. And that we have technological challenges. But one thing we do know very well. We know how to plug into God and switch on our light. They may hear what we cannot hear, but we know what to do about what they hear. We need each other if we're going to change our world from being in a state of darkness. With our brightly beams of glory, of the glorious gospel. And that's what Peter said in Acts 2 verse 17. In the last days, God says, "I will pour out my spirit on all people. Your sons and your daughters will prophesy. Your young men will see visions. Your old men will dream dreams. Even on your servants, both men and women, I will pour out my spirit in those days and they will prophesy." So Eli says to Samuel, "Go back, lie down on the same spot. But this time, when you hear the sound, this is how you respond. When it happens, then say, 'Speak, Lord, for your servant is listening.'" That is what mentoring is all about. It's about discipling and teaching our young people how to respond with, "Speak, Lord, for your servant is listening." We may not feel what our young, what they are going through, but if they tell us what they are struggling with, we can show them how to respond to these situations. God is calling us. He wants our attention. Let us attune our ears to the sound of His call. So as we close, whatever darkness you have been going through, during the pandemic, God has been trying to get your attention that the switch is off. We have been overtaken by darkness. God is wanting to awaken you out of your slumber to keep your lamp trimmed and shining brightly into the darkness all around you. God is using His tuning fork to attune your ears to the sound of the little song we used to sing in Sunday school. This little light of mine, I'm going to let it shine. Let it shine. Let it shine. And when members of your family and the community hear the sound of that light, they will be crying out, "Please put on the light and let the darkness flee." Now, you see, they say that the darkest hour is just before dawn. But when the light of the sun rises over the Hottentots' hardened mountains, the darkness has to flee at the speed of 186,000 miles per second. That is what will happen when we can sing with the songwriter, "Lord, the light of your light is shining." In the midst of the darkness shining, Jesus, light of the world, shine upon us. Set us free by your truth. You now bring us. Shine on me. Shine, Jesus, shine. For this land with your Father's glory. So as we go back to church to be refueled, let us come from the presence of the Lord to be all that Jesus has called us to be in the Sermon on the Mount. In that favorite verse of scripture from Matthew 5, 14 to 15. You are the light of the world. In the same way, let your light so shine before others that they may see your good deeds and glorify your Father in heaven. So as we go back to church for the first time, and in spite of the darkness that the pandemic brought, are you ready to switch on your light just as Jesus did at his first participation in the temple after his dark experience in the wilderness? He read from the book of Isaiah 42 verse 6. I, the Lord, have called you in righteousness. I will take hold of your hand. I will keep you and I will make you to be a covenant for the people of and light for the Gentiles, to open the eyes that are blind, to free the captives from prison, and to release the dungeons who sit in darkness. Let's pray together. Father, we thank you so much for the power of the light of God, in whom there is no shadow of turning. Thank you, Lord, that we can turn to you this morning and be refueled and energized with all that we need to shine our lights brightly into our dark world. We confess, Lord, that some of us have lost that shine. We've allowed the pandemic to take away all the energy that we once had to shine for you. But we come this morning and we put all that behind us and we say with confidence, shine, Jesus, shine on me first, so that I may take your light to a dark world. We receive that power now in Jesus' mighty name. And all God's people said, amen. Oh, thank you so much for being with us again this morning. Thank you for allowing the Lord to give you the ears to hear what we as the church need to be doing as we move into the new norm with all its challenges. We can make a difference because we are the light of the world. God bless you and look forward to seeing you again next week.
There is a candle in every soul, some brightly burning, some dark and cold. There is a spirit who brings a fire, ignites a candle and makes his home. So carry your candle, run to the darkness, seek out the hopeless, confused and torn, and hold out your candle. some other way. Seeing now your sister, she's been robbed and lied to.
Go light your